All right. Thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today and for typing in all of your answers. Glad to see there is a lot of people here and from a wide variety of backgrounds as well. So this webinar is about engaging and upskilling your remote workforce with AR. And a couple of things before we get started and before we introduce ourselves here. Number one is that we will be doing some, showing some examples at the end. So feel free to have your mobile phone next to you and the Zapper app ready to go, just so that you can participate and check out some of the things that we're going to be talking about today. We like to keep things interactive. The other thing is, of course, questions and comments. We always welcome questions. We always welcome comments. So please do feel free to type in the Q&A box. This is a very strange time that we're living in, as we all well know by now. So we have some ideas, we have some thoughts, and we're also learning as we go too. So this can be a brainstorming session as well. So feel free to pitch in any thoughts and ideas that you think might be helpful for the group, for us to discuss, and go ahead and type that either in the chat box or in the Q&A. So who is on this call? First of all, there's me. I'm Daniel Hartz. I'm the customer success manager here at Zapper. And as you can see, I'm joined by Destry.
Hello, everyone. My name is Destry Hildenbrand. I'm an instructional designer with GP Strategies. And I've been working with Zapper and AR now for the past 3-4 years in trying to build and explore and engage and do all kinds of cool things with augmented reality in learning and development.
Thank you very much, Destry. And Destry and I have, we've presented at a couple of different L&D events in the past, once at Realities 360. This was back in 2019 in March, if I'm not mistaken, and again at DevLearn, also last year in Vegas. And now this is how we're presenting moving forward, at least for the time being. So with that, first things to start with is, why use AR?
That's a great way for us to get started today. So I think this really helps us kind of level set exactly where we are and what we're doing. So augmented reality, of all the realities, right? We've got a whole bunch out there now. We've got augmented reality, we've got mixed reality, which is augmented reality on steroids. We've got virtual reality, which is the full immersion inside of a space. And then we've got 360 video, which is sort of like baby virtual reality, right? So we've got all these different types of immersive landscapes that we can go into. So what makes AR unique, or what makes AR special for what we do as learning and development professionals? So I would say that there's a couple things. Augmented reality lends itself really well to our workforce for a couple different reasons. Number one is that, and we'll kind of get into this here in a second too, is that everybody's prepared already for it. We've all got devices that can do augmented reality. Everybody can download the Zapper app and make it happen. But it gives us a snapshot or an immediate kind of into the moment of need for training. We all run into situations where, on a daily basis, I'll run into a wall when I'm working with a program or working with a client. And I'm like, I know I can do that. Hang on. And my moment of need is Googling something, or I look real quick here and there to try to find an answer, or grab a page somewhere. Or if your organization's anything like mine, we tend to not have things quite as organized as you'd like. And you're like, I know I have a link for that. Hang on, let me see if I can find it. So imagine now, in their moment of need, if they had this information, let's say they just scan a Zap code and it pulls up a curated list of all the stuff they need for that particular question or task or hurdle that they've now faced. So that's probably one of the biggest things to start off with, is that augmented reality lends itself really well. I pull my phone up, I scan it, it brings me more information, and it helps me over that barrier or that hurdle. And second cool thing about it is that not only is it sort of ease of access and helps me with that moment of need and learning, but it's exciting, it's interesting. I don't have to just go to a web page, right? I don't have to click a link here. I can scan something and maybe a video pops up and talks to me about it, or it curates information for me, or it pulls up a 3D model, or gosh, there's limits to what you can do with it, but it makes it much more engaging and exciting for your learners, for your participants, especially if they're not able to come back into the office now. You know, we're all kind of in our own little spaces, right? Whatever those are. Some of us are lucky enough to have a whole room where they can put Star Wars posters up in the back, you know, but some people don't. Maybe it's just a kitchen counter. Maybe it's just something you're on the deck, or hopefully the weather holds out for you so you can have a quiet space with everybody now in there. But yeah, I mean, you can engage and interact with people in a more interesting way. And I think excitement is sometimes overlooked a little bit, but I think it's a huge, huge piece to not only retention, but also why we use augmented reality.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point, Destry. I think that's something we were talking about before we jumped on the call, is just the importance of having fun when learning. And I think that, you know, I think it is a really important component, because ultimately, the more fun something is, especially if it can get a little bit hands-on, or, you know, if you're able to engage with what could otherwise be relatively dull or mundane content in a more fun and interesting way, I think it really does encourage that learning, and it gets people more involved into it.
100%. And especially now, maybe everybody's taking the same thing from the same, you know, we're all working from the same rectangle, right? I mean, that's how we've sort of viewed all of our training and everything up to this point. Well, maybe, you know, not even maybe, but absolutely, augmented reality helps us get out of that, you know, a little bit, and to turn, you know, I mean, we're still looking through a rectangle in our phone, but what we're seeing can be completely different and immersive in different ways.
Yeah, well, we have a couple of examples later on that we can go through. And I think you're absolutely right. I mean, that's one of the great things about augmented reality, is the ability. I mean, you always use the rectangle of your device to access augmented reality. What I like about it is that it does, first of all, make you look away from your normal computer screen. And second of all, sometimes if the content is done in this way, it really makes you actually get up out of your seat and walk around, or at least just move your body, which I think there's a lot to be said about making learning a physical experience, not just very passive and kind of just sitting there watching it.
Yeah, I mean, you can, it's sort of like a little portal that takes you where you want to go, and you can kind of explore that. Yeah, getting up, getting around, even if it's just in your living room, in your basement, you know, and in your front yard, who knows? Yeah. But yeah, there's lots of ways we can engage people to do that.
Absolutely. And so we're starting to talk about it a bit. So what exactly are the benefits of AR?
So the biggest benefit that I've found with augmented reality in the experiences that I've had is that it is, and again, this is, I'll preface this with, each company has their own BYOD policy, right? Your own bring your own device policy. But for the most part, we are conditioned as for good or bad, we're conditioned that we really want to have the coolest technology and the latest and greatest in digital devices. So although that becomes a very expensive proposition for us personally, professionally, it does lend itself well, because all those devices have everything they need to be augmented reality enabled. They have the accelerometers, they have the gyroscopes, all the internal workings that make it all happen. So on our end as developers, we don't have to worry about, wait, you know, I don't have to be as worried about, do they have a device that will do this? Because most people just automatically have that device. So the ease of access option is where we are, because mobile AR is probably what, 85-ish percent of all the augmented reality experiences that we have, just because we haven't, I don't know, the head-worn stuff looks kind of funky and cool and weird sometimes, but it hasn't quite caught up with what our phones can do. So everything we have is right there, ease of access. Everybody's got it. Everybody's conditioned to download an app if they need to, or even now, WebAR. I've seen that. We've worked a little bit with some of the Zapper WebAR stuff, but WebAR is another part that you don't even have to download an app if that 5 to 10 seconds is too much to to get through, you know.
For some, it totally is.
Exactly. I know it's a barrier. And what we've seen is that all these types of things, this ease of access, I pull up my phone, I scan something, it takes me to where I need to go. It shows me what I need to see, and it engages me with this augmented reality experience. The fact that it's all just right there, and we're already conditioned to do it. So we're conditioned to be on our phones and do different things. So good, bad, or indifferent, we're ready. We're all prepared. Our learners and our participants are trained already on the devices to make it happen. And now they can just kind of really dive in and start experiencing.
Yeah. So I think on that point, you mentioned, you know, the headsets and everything. I think there's certainly a time and place for that. I think ultimately it ends up being, it's a lot of gear and things to invest in. And that's one of the beautiful things about AR. It's just like you said. I mean, we already all have the devices that allow us to do this. So that's one of the benefits of specifically augmented reality versus these other technologies, is just like you said, ease of access. And that's what we at Zapra absolutely love about augmented reality, is the fact that for many people, they are able to access it. And that's when we say democratization of augmented reality, that's oftentimes what we're referring to, is the ability for pretty much anyone to be able to get involved and actually see it. You don't need expensive hardware. You don't need any special software. It just, like you're saying, Destry, you either download an app, and even now you don't need to do that. You just scan a QR code and it just magically appears.
Yeah, very much so. So that ease of access is a huge benefit of augmented reality. The other couple ones we have on there, updating information and from a design and development perspective, is pretty seamless too. Once you have an experience developed and you send it out or you print it off and you put it somewhere, that never has to change. I mean, on the back end, we can update everything monthly, daily, yearly, hourly, whatever you need to do. And you just publish that directly out and it's automatically updated. We don't have to reprint anything off. We don't have to do new zap codes. We don't have to do new anything. It makes it very easy to update that existing content on there. Now, again, there's times when you will have to build new, obviously. But if you've got reoccurring information shares, or you've got, you know, content that tends to update, the hardest part about having paper copies of anything is that when something changes, you have to weigh the pros and cons. All right, has enough change that it warrants the cost, time, expense of me updating it and then reprinting everything off? Or do we wait and then kind of see where that's at, you know? So then we run the risk of, well, if I don't take that time to update this paper copy, how much damage is potentially there for something like that too? So, but it's easy to update the information from the back end and then just publish it out to everything. And then I think the last one here is probably the biggest one, and that's sort of the elephant in the room, right? That engagement and retention option. It's exciting, it's interesting, it's different. And sometimes those three things alone can really enable learners to kind of take that next step.
Yeah, absolutely. I think on that point, we worked with a research lab called Neuro Insight, where basically they brought in subjects or people into a room, put this like swimming cap almost on their head with a bunch of wires sticking out of it, and just started monitoring brain activity, kind of like you can see in the picture there on the right hand side of the screen with the brain, and it's all yellow and pink. Basically, what we're doing is just taking a look at the brain activity of people who are looking at sort of regular quote unquote content, such as, you know, like on a TV screen, like a video, or just reading something, and then comparing the brain activity of someone who is looking at the same content through AR and being able to engage with it rather than just reading it. And what we saw was that there was a 95% increase in engagement from the brain. So that's almost double the amount of engagement that people have with the content. So they're like twice as engaged. And I mean, that's a great number to look at, in my opinion. And what's much more important than the engagement is the retention. Meaning once they've been involved with the content, how well can they actually remember that which you taught them? And what we found from this report and from this study was that there was an increase in retention of 70%, 70. So that's significant which means that, you know, the time that you're spending teaching people, and this is something I've heard from a lot of L&D professionals, is that they're spending a lot of time creating great content, doing everything they can, going through all the theories and, you know, putting everything they have into it, and then people just don't remember it. Augmented reality, you know, just by the nature of, like you said, Destry, just by the nature of it being different, interactive, fun, interesting, the retention goes up. And that's what we were talking about earlier.
Very much so. I think and one of the big takeaways is that they're no longer passive, right? They're no longer passive recipients of content or information. Right. They're active. They're actively seeking it out or exploring the next piece. It's not a next button. It's an exploration of what's going on. So
yeah,
definitely.
I think you just said next button. That reminds me of a question that I've encountered a couple of times with some L&D professionals just about the LMS versus AR debate, and I assume this is something that you hear as well. You know, especially now that we're all working from home and everyone's at home, so this in-person stuff, which is very much kind of the nature of augmented reality, we have fewer opportunities in some ways to engage with AR because it's an in-person thing. So, you know, I guess the point I'm making is that the just-in-time stuff that you were talking about earlier, this moment of need, this learner engagement and retention, these are some points about where AR can fit in versus just relying heavily or solely on videos and the LMS. Do you have any anything to add on that?
Yeah, I think tracking everything in your LMS, the LMSs are a tricky thing. LMSs are a whole nother hour plus conversation amongst everything. But in general, your LMSs are just, they're tracking and they're giving you different levels of detail as to how people have done things. Now, different LMSs do different things. But I think the biggest thing is that if these moment of needs don't always necessarily get tracked in the LMS, right? I mean, this isn't something that always happens or gets tracked all the time. But if there's content that you need tracked to be put in there, you can create documentation that's wrapped in a SCORM package. You can drop it into an LMS. And when they bring it up on the screen, they can scan it, they can engage with it. So AR can be integrated into that. And I think that actually leads us to a really good point too, is that augmented reality isn't necessarily the end all be all of your training solution. It's part of your blended solution. So you've got web-based trainings, you've got instructor-led trainings, and you've got some augmented reality that you drop in there. These are all different ways to engage. And then all of these things together sort of fit in. And then we can push that out to our LMS for tracking and see about that. But one of the hiccups that we do run into, and this is a challenge that we're all facing as L&D professionals here, is that the technology that is driving augmented reality does not seamlessly integrate with most LMSs. So we do have to have some workarounds where it's, can I wrap this in a SCORM package? You know, what are the benefits of me, you know, putting augmented reality out to an LMS versus, you know, maybe this is just kind of a standalone sort of training. This is sort of that extra piece that if people want to go down the rabbit hole a little bit further. So those are questions that we ask a lot. So I've wrapped some things in SCORM packages and dropped them up there into an LMS for tracking. And we've also done some things where they're just kind of their own thing. You know, it's just a standalone piece. We can get some, you know, Zapper does a pretty good job of having some high level tracking, so we have some general ideas of what's going on. And I know we've had a lot of comments and questions, but you're not alone in keeping you up at night, Daniel. So I know you just said it, these are the questions that keep him up at night. Well, you're not alone. A lot of people are thinking that. And I think that's also something that we kind of, as professionals, L&D professionals, we have to kind of throw that back towards the developers a little bit too and be like, hey, you know, what kinds of things can we partner with? How can we help you help us? Help me help you. It's a very Jerry Maguire kind of a thing, right? Help me help you kind of a piece. So I think that's still something that's evolving, but there are options that we have. So
yeah, and I think you're absolutely right. There's certainly a lot of stuff we can cover. And I guess just while we're on the topic, a question came in from Pablo just now about how can I use contents of my LMS to visualize in AR. He says that he needs a team to think and recreate this content AR based. Maybe that's something we can talk about later, or if you have an answer now, Destry, we can quickly jump into it.
You know, one of the biggest things that we do is we try to look at the overall objectives of what it is we're trying to accomplish. And then we start to kind of divest those objectives into, all right, what are these buckets of how we can deliver this content in a way that's meaningful, that's blended, that's effective. And I think that's where you start to identify sort of, you know, I can put this in this bucket. I have an AR bucket. You know, what are some ways that we could get these points across into an augmented reality experience? Maybe it's a 30-second experience. Maybe it's a 5-minute experience. I don't know. But that's how you kind of have to start, you know, finding those buckets of this is going to be best delivered as a web page. This is going to be best delivered as a PDF document. You know, maybe it's a job aid that they have. This is going to be best delivered in a way on a web-based training so they can anytime, anywhere. And maybe this is a great way to reinforce one of the concepts that they think are really important, and this is my AR bucket. So that's one of the approaches that I kind of take, and we can kind of maybe open it up to the community too a little bit later to kind of help answer that question. But that would be my initial reaction when you asked that. So
yeah, great points there. Thank you. So as far as use cases, because you know we've been talking about the power of AR and why L&D professionals should be looking into augmented reality. So what are some of these use cases that you've been seeing or that you've heard other L&D professionals taking advantage of AR?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of really great opportunities for augmented reality. I think this kind of lends us into why we're here today too, because augmented reality is one of those things that everyone can experience everywhere. I know we look at some of the different use cases, and we will hear too about, you know, well, hang on, a scavenger hunt, I'm in my house. I don't know if I can do that. But there's ways I think that we can reach out and still engage the remote, you know, workforce, help upskill them using these. So if we start maybe from the top and we'll go clockwise around, right? So if we look at the HR, there's some general onboarding pieces. You know, I worked with a client a while back where team introductions, a lot of the people weren't in their offices all the time. So we enhanced their nameplates with augmented reality introductions. It was super
cool.
Simple, super easy. Hi, my name's Destry. I'm a multimedia learning and development specialist. If you guys ever have questions about these types of things, definitely stop by my desk and see me. It was real quick, real easy. Everyone sat down and recorded a little 5-minute video. And then we just said, hey, you know what? Go around and meet people. And if they weren't there, they could meet them virtually. So that was kind of a fun little, you know, kind of just a fun little augmented reality experience. Think about, I've worked with a few companies who have said, hey, you know what? We use it as a daily update. So imagine if you had a quota or a goal or timely information. Maybe it's health and safety related. So maybe you're home, you have your little card, you have your zap code, you scan that and there's a little video or a little message or an updated updated analytics of whatever it is that you need for the day to continue doing your job. So again, that's that just in time. You know, I have this need for information and this is what it's giving me.
And that goes into the tech, the way the tech works, ZapWorks, the actual software development, our tools that you use to build the AR content is this, what we call instant publishing, which means that some of the other AR platforms you use to build AR, you actually need to update your app in order to get new content there. And this can take a while. Not everyone wants to update the app. On the Zapper system, ZapWorks specifically, what you do is just press the button, just publish, and instantaneously everywhere that your Zap code or this QR code or whatever, wherever that is in the world, the next time someone scans it, the latest content that you've updated will be shown. And there's no one has to press any buttons or anything. It just automatically, or as I like to say, auto-magically happens.
Auto magic. I like it. I think that's perfect in this, in where we're at right now, you know, and where maybe our new normal takes us in the future. You know, yeah. Who knows? Like things are so unique right now that what that new normal is going to look like is very much in the air. But I think it does lend itself to a much more digital and distance, you know, kind of space. I think there's always a place for being with people. Like, trust me, I miss being in front of a classroom. I miss being in front of some people and talking to them and getting that immediate feedback. But this kind of lends itself really well to what we're here today talking about, which is upskilling our remote workforce, or in this case, you know, keeping them up to date with the latest and greatest, whether it's information or training. We can always send emails. We can always point people to links. And sometimes that's what we have to do because there's enough information to do that. But imagine if they just wake up in the morning, they walk into their new office or their new kitchen or whatever their office is now, and they just scan something and there's the information updated. You know what? The management's come in the morning, or HR or whoever it is has come in the morning and said, hey, you know what? This is the new stuff. Hey guys, welcome. It's a Tuesday. I just want to remind you what actual day it was because they all just ended Y now for everybody for most part, you know? So it's a Tuesday and here's what's happening. And so maybe that would be a fantastic way for people. Even maybe leadership does that. They cycle through your different management or, you know, CO, you know, the operating officers and everybody. They're like, hey, you know what? I know we're in a really weird position right now, but I want to I appreciate everybody. You know, just a morning update, something like that, I think would go a long ways in augmented reality. Although it's not like augmented reality like we think, right? I think a lot of people think augmented reality and they're like, oh, flashy lights and pictures. And it's like, no, sometimes it can be a little more basic. It can still just be that just-in-time tool for you, especially in kind of the situations we're in now. But yeah, the updates daily, you know, the information dissemination. And then as we get kind of over to the left there in the 9 o'clock hour, we start to see where we can really start to engage people to do something. So when we talk about, you know, interactive or enhanced job aids, again, curation is a big thing that I kind of push with augmented reality because I know that that's a struggle most organizations have trying to find all that stuff. But if you had just this one task on your job aid and you scanned it and it brought everything up that you needed or the access to everything that you wanted, maybe it shows you a part or a step in a process and a 3D model comes up and shows you how those two pieces fit together. This is how you do it. And then you scan the next part. This is how you do it. I mean, these are all very viable uses. And it's also things that people could do from home or remote or wherever they're at. You could show them this one step. Hey, I can explain it to you. I can draw a diagram, but sometimes those 2D diagrams don't do, you know, some of these things justice. So if you have a 3D model, if you have a CAD, you know, a team that works in CAD and they can export that into an OBJ or a POD file, something like that, that you can then just show people, hey, you know what, this is it, this is what it does. And sometimes that alone is worth it. And in augmented reality and using the Zapper tool, Studio especially, lends itself really well to doing that. You guys just had a really cool webinar on that not too long ago with the eye that came apart. That was really slick.
That was awesome. That one is I think that's a fantastic example that actually goes really well into both the learning and development sphere. This specifically what we call the exploding 3D model. It sounds much worse when you say exploding eyeball, so we say exploding 3D model. It's a cool one because it goes both into learning and development as well as into marketing and sales, because ultimately what you're doing with that is taking a complicated piece of equipment, or in this case, it was an eye, so it was great for teaching students about biology and you know, different elements that of an eyeball, and you're able to basically break it up into its constituent parts and then learn about each one of those parts individually. And if you're looking at that on a video or you know on a, just a picture with like lines drawn, you just kind of glance at it and that's about it. If you're able to look at it from all different angles and actually move your phone and like we were talking about earlier, physically moving your body around this thing and spinning the paper and being able to see it, or if you're able to position it in your living room and walk around it, I mean, it's just so powerful. And I think you'll end up, it ends up being fun. That's what we were talking about earlier. And you want to engage with learning material, which I think is a really rare thing. And most cases, I mean, I know I struggled with school specifically because it was boring. It wasn't fun. But I actually love learning when it is fun and it's something I want to know. The escape room example is one that I know a lot of people ask about. And actually, Heather was asking, just mentioned that she's interested in as well. And Destry, you were saying that you had some ideas on escape room types that people can do even when they're stuck at home.
Yeah, I think the escape room and the scavenger hunt concept still lends itself really well. So I'll start with the scavenger hunt real quick, because I have a great example of it. So here in my town, they created a so obviously kids can't go places. We can't go places. You can't go to parks or anything like that right now. But what they did was one of the kids that was at home, and I wish I would have thought of this, created a bingo card of different locations around the city. So kids could get in the car, still get out, you know, roll the windows down, and mark off on their bingo card when they travel to different places. So think about something like that, where you could also maybe enhance that with some additional information of, you know, when they enhance some additional information about those locations. Maybe it's a power plant, or maybe, it, you know, we have a power plant here. We've got Quaker Oats is here. They, you know, every Thursday, every couple Thursdays, it smells like crunch berries in our town. So that's how it all kind of goes down. But yeah, so imagine if you could scan a little bit, learn a little bit more about it. Or the escape room, scavenger hunt, you know, escape rooms really are only, they're just experiences that make you think and have a puzzle to move on to the next step. I mean, if we break it down to its brass, like we break it down to its bare bones, it is, hey, you know what? What's an interesting and fun way I can try to solve a riddle to gain progress in this piece? So how do I move forward? And you could do that. You could do that anywhere. You could create puzzles or riddles or a box that shows up that you have to do a certain color coded, click on certain color coded pieces to open, to then say, all right, now move on to the next one, and you can scan the next one. I think that there's just a lot of ways you can do that. You could do it in your own backyard. You could do it on a daily walk. You could do it, you know, anywhere you want to put stuff up. Think about, again, another way you could engage is, if we did 3D, 360 photospheres of different locations. So maybe it's the Great Wall of China. Maybe it's the Statue of Liberty. And I put the zap codes on papers, and I put them on each side of the fence in my backyard. And I send the kids out, and I'm like, all right, go explore the world. And they go out and they scan it, you know, and it's not super crazy complicated. The photosphere is relatively easy with the templates that are provided in Studio to just put it together. I mean, less than 10 minutes and you have a real good understanding of what's going on, and you can create those type of really cool immersive experiences that people could scan, and all of a sudden they're in a 360 view. And we have an example of something very similar to that here coming up, but you can really kind of move around and see everything that's there. It's ideal because, number one, people can do it from anywhere. So regardless of whether they're in an office or whether they're home or they're remote, wherever, they can do it anywhere. The design and development time is minimal once you get past that initial sort of learning hurdle. And there's lots of great tutorials. There's lots of great help out there on the Zapworks forum. So if you have questions, people are very responsive to help you out through it. But it doesn't take a ton of time to make these types of things. So your development time is less. And in the end, the engagement and experience of it is, again, that fun, that excitement, that interest. You could do this with places in the world. You could do this with locations of your business. You know, a lot of people work in places where they have locations everywhere, but you're probably never going to visit anything overseas. You know, the likelihood of you visiting someone a location overseas is less than what it would be here. Heck, even in the same town, I worked at an organization that had three different locations in the same town, and they said, "Hey, can you go to this place?" I'm like, "I didn't even know we had that place. I had no idea what that was." But imagine if you just took some pictures of it and everybody experienced it virtually like that. I scan it. Hey, you know what? Here's the Cedar Rapids plant. Here's the Iowa City plant. Here's the Waterloo plant. And everybody gets to experience a little bit of what it's like there. So you can do that kind of stuff. Heck, you can create escape rooms or that gamified sort of experience in Designer with just having little pictures. Hey, you know what? Scan this picture and it has a question that pops up and says, hey, you know what? This is the clue. This is the riddle. I mean, it doesn't have to be a full blown, I have to find a key, put it in the lock, turn it a certain way kind of a thing. So there's different levels to all of this. And I think when we start talking about that, the scavenger hunt, gamification, escape room, they all sort of blend together a little bit. You know, we can find elements of them to really build those unique augmented reality experiences using the Zapworks tools that can be enjoyed, experienced, and engaged anywhere.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I really love what you're saying about keeping the that it doesn't need to necessarily be complicated. If you have the technical chops and the time and the desire and it makes sense. And I think that's a really crucial thing. And we'll talk about that in a second about it has to make sense. You need to be doing justice to what you're showing. It does not need to be complicated. Some of our most successful and most popular AR content that we here at Zapper have created for some of our clients are actually some of our most basic experiences. We have one, it's our Bombay Sapphire experience that everyone absolutely loves. And as far as the technical aspect of that one, it's one of the more basic ones. It's just really well done. And it's simple and it's elegant. And so I think you're absolutely right, Destra. You know, it does not need to be hard for it to be effective or helpful or even fun. And I absolutely also love the idea of crunchberry smelling Thursdays.
It's fun for a while. It's fun for a while.
And then it gets old and then you just want, please come up with a new cereal.
Exactly.
So as far as what makes a successful AR experience, and this is something that is always important to remember, even for people who are stuck at home, you're asking them to do this. It's part of required training. It's still really important to make it really obvious for people what they need to do and why. And so we have this little formula. It's called the 3 C's for success. And as you can see, there's 3 things. Each one of them starts with C. So the first one is the context. And ultimately the context, typically we're referring to put yourself in your end users or in your learner's shoes. So are they going to be in a place where they can engage with AR content? You know, are they connected to Wi-Fi or 4G or LTE? Everyone's at home now, so probably the context will be fine. And it makes sense. I guess some things to think about is, you know, if they don't have access to certain portals, or if they're, you know, they need certain passwords that they may not have access to. These are things that you just need to think about. Seems obvious. It can be easy to forget, and we've all been there where we just forget that something needs to be done. So that context piece is nonetheless still important. The second one here is call to action, which is vital because what it means is telling people what they need to do exactly. If you're using the Zap code, then people need to download the Zapper app and scan the code. That's the way we used to do things. It was the only way we could do things. As we've talked about previously, WebAR is now an option, so you can use a QR code and launch the augmented reality content directly in your browser, in the end user's browser, so that would be Safari or Chrome, so they don't need to download an app. A lot of people don't like downloading apps, it gets cluttered. So it's really important, nonetheless, to tell people what exactly they need to do. Whether it's, you know, take out your phone, scan this QR code, launch the thing. The other important piece, and we'll show you a couple of examples of this after this slide, is why should they do this? You know, we're constantly being asked to download stuff or look at things. So what's the benefit to me? It's the constant question that everyone's always asking. And finally, the content, the payoff, basically. So, finally, I've agreed, I'm scanning this stuff, I'm doing all these things. Ultimately, the content does need to be of enough quality and interesting enough to make it worth it for them. It should be entertaining, educational, helpful, useful, et cetera, et cetera. And so when you have these 3 C's, that's what we're seeing makes for a successful AR experience. We're not actually going to cover analytics today, but what we do see is in your analytics, you can easily see whether or not your experiences are doing well. And if the analytics don't seem to fit quite right, or if they're not matching expectations, oftentimes it makes sense to start with looking at the context, looking at the call to action, and finally looking at the content and just making sure that all 3 of those C's are perfect or as close to perfect. Outstanding might be a better term to use because perfection is scary. So with that, Destry, did you have anything to add on this, or should we jump into the examples?
No, let's jump into the examples so people want to play.
Yeah, let's make this fun. So this is one of yours that you made. This looks like a conference corridor.
It is. It was, I shot the 360 pictures on a Gear 360. So very, you know, I got it for like, I don't know, a nickel. It was crazy cheap. It was like 50 bucks for this 360 camera. But this is the Fairmont Hotel in San Jose. So when we were there a couple of years back. But what you'll see here is when you scan this, and actually the call to action down at the bottom.
Please
there,
do scan, by the way.
Yeah, please do scan. So with the Zapper app on your phone, go ahead and scan this. And then what you're going to see is it's going to take you right there. And it's going to help you to avoid a few of the common issues that we run into at conferences, including fires, hazardous materials, and soccer balls. So that's it's pretty true to life. If anybody's been to a conference, you're gonna see all those types of things. I know it's a little like you didn't expect it 100%. You're like, oh, soccer balls, huh? But yeah, it's a thing. But what this does is it gives you an example of kind of an immersive way that you could bring people into an environment. Now, this one's enhanced a little bit because it has some different options that you can click on and some different pieces that are happening. But in general, you can create a photosphere that has a 360 image in very short order. So the template's there, you find the 360 image you want to use, and it brings it right in. And what you can do is you can transport someone somewhere else. So you can move around, look up, look down. It gives you a general idea of what's happening. And what you're going to see here too is that on this particular this target, this trigger, we've got our code, we've got what it is, and we've got that call to action down at the bottom. And I actually have the call to actions on most of mine taking up quite a bit of space just to make sure everyone knows that this is what they're going to be doing. So obviously these were all developed pre-web AR a little bit there, but you know, download, scan, experience. So just something simple like that really kind of gets people in. Okay, this is what I got to do. And then especially if it's out of context for them, you know, if you're not there to say, hey, everybody, get out your Zapper app and take a look. So hopefully something like this really helps guide them down that path. But again, this is that 360 fully immersive. Imagine if you created three of these and you put them up in your office, in your room, had everybody do that, you know, print it off or put it on a screen. You know, you can scan it from there too, but it will take you different places, have you explore different things. This one obviously is just an example of a hallway here in a hotel. But think about maybe a production floor. Think about an office setting. You know, hey, I know right now, especially you can't come in and see what we're doing here, but here's some pictures. Here's a way to immerse yourself into that. And maybe this also gets us thinking that we need to start creating a 360 library of content too down the road. So that's not a bad play, especially because cameras are $200 or less, a relatively minimal investment, and you can create some really engaging AR experiences with them just by transporting people places. So, you know, a couple hours of your time, $200 to $250 for a camera, and you can develop these things. Again, minimal effort, maximum return on an interesting, engaging project.
Absolutely. And just on that point, there are a couple questions from Michael and from Martine about if you can use video, 360 video, and you absolutely can. The one thing to just keep in mind with that is just the size of the file, because when you scan this code, it is downloaded onto the mobile app. And so for some people, they don't want to download, you know, 50 megabytes or even 100 or 500 megabytes of content onto their phone. And it just takes a while. So that's something to keep in mind. I'm conscious of time here, so I'd like to make sure we get through. We have about 12, 13 minutes left, so I just want to make sure we get through all the other the last couple examples here. This is another fun one that you made, Destry.
Yeah, this was a gamified experience that I made. We were at a conference in San Jose, and this was the SAP Center where the San Jose Sharks play, and created a little gamified experience there. If you scan the code here, and then you kind of move out to a flat area there. It'll pull up this little game, and you can try to get the puck past the goalie. So
Yeah, it's a fun one for those of you who are testing it out. These are just things as well. It's, I guess the one point here as well is that sometimes I've actually seen L&D professionals using augmented reality as a reward occasionally for completing certain things correctly. I don't know if that's something in your experience, Destry, do you see that?
I haven't actually, no, but that's kind of cool. That's a cool way to do it. So.
Yeah, so I mean, like, you know, with a game like this, there's this is just showing you the possibilities of it. I'm not sure if there is an actual learning specific example here. What I have seen is, you know, you can use something like this or a face filter to give people a little bit of a hey, well done sort of a thing. Here's something fun to do.
Yeah, no, I think, and the idea behind this one here was that we actually, it was part of an overall scavenger hunt where people just learning a little bit more about the area. So it was just a fun way to engage. That was the idea. So,
yeah. Okay. That makes sense. Speaking of scavenger hunt and getting a tour, this is one that actually, that we made at Zapper, and this is our office, here. So if you scan this code, it's actually two photospheres. So similar to the first one that we looked at the conference center, this is two photospheres. Destry's moving us around. And when you scan one photosphere, you can take a look. When you enter one photosphere, you can take a look at that area and then go out the door. We have a second office down the corridor to the left, and press that door button, you watch a little video of us walking down, and then you appear in the other office. And this is a great way just to, again, it's a little bit of a scavenger hunt, although I guess that's a bit of a push, because it's more of a way to just get introduced to an office. And this was what Destry was talking about earlier with, you know, with learning about your offices and different locations. So, we can send all these examples afterwards as well. I want to make sure that we have enough time for questions, because if I'm not mistaken, we have about 9 minutes left. As far as next steps, for anyone who hasn't had a chance to start, what do you typically recommend, Destry, for L&D professionals?
I think the biggest thing is just to get started. You know, like the steps we have here, just sign up for a Zapper account, you know, get the demo account and start exploring some of the tools that are available. You know, make sure you visit the forums. They're going to be really helpful in answering any questions. There's a show and tell section that kind of gives you some ideas of examples of what's actually happening out there. Try to pinpoint maybe one use case that you can get started with. It's important that when you're kind of doing that, though, show other people in the organization some examples and help them kind of generate ideas about it too. Get them involved, especially stakeholders, management, things like that. Help them to really get started, you know, get them interested, get them, you know, eager. And once they start generating ideas, that'll lend itself better towards getting people to approve different things and investments. That's always a good thing. And then start building some content, share it with people, get feedback, and then repeat, you know. I mean, the biggest thing here is just to get started with it.
Absolutely. Yeah, I think this is it. It's really just about just try it out. I mean, first of all, we have a free 30-day trial, which makes things easy. It's very, very, very low risk. And ultimately it is a new medium, and it's a new thing overall. So the only way to really get comfortable is just by testing. And don't be afraid to make mistakes. I mean, it's all the same things that we all teach when trying anything new, is just start playing around with it. No one's judging you here. And there's always room to grow and to learn. And there's a lot of great support, especially on the forum there. Finally.
And if you do something, just real quick, if you do something cool, share it, because I'm always looking for more cool stuff.
Absolutely. Like
I'll share anything I do if you share all the stuff you do, because that's how we get better at this. So.
It's so true. And then you're a master at sharing, Destry. I've seen you're very active on the forum, which is awesome. And the feedback and the commentary is really helpful. And that's what I love about our community, is we're very active, very helpful and encouraging. So please do go to the forum, the Zapworks forum. One last piece before we jump into the questions. This is a really exciting thing that we're really pleased to announce. And that's an ebook specifically for learning and development professionals, and it's called How to Integrate AR into Your Learning and Development Program. So that's all that's going to be available to you right after the end of this webinar. So please stick around when we close it. Hopefully, fingers crossed, it should work, that there'll be a little pop-up that comes up so you can enter your email and download the and if it doesn't work, then we'll send it to you in another way. Thank you very much for your time. Any questions? There's actually a few here that have been coming up. Let's see. First one was from Lucinda from the very beginning about, can a learner download an experience on their phone like they can do with documents? Yes, when you scan something, it shows up in your recents. So when you open the Zapper app specifically and in WebAR, in the little hamburger menu on the upper left-hand side, you'll see recents. So you can access stuff there. Let's see. Another question would be, would WebAR work for an AR photo booth? Absolutely, WebAR works for the photo booth. WebAR pretty much works for everything. That's what's absolutely fantastic about the WebAR is it's really meant to, in some ways, replace the app entirely. We're still working on one final element, and that's world tracking, which is relatively advanced 3D stuff where you can position, you know, like furniture in your living room. That specifically is the only thing that's not quite there yet. We have a slightly less intense version of it, I suppose you can say, which is called instant tracking, which means you can put like a glass or a vase or something smaller on your table. Something really big like a sofa, for example, is not quite there yet. But otherwise, yeah, absolutely, you can certainly use the photo booth feature in AR. Ellie is asking about if we have any suggestions on where to find panoramic or 360, I'm assuming images. Do you have any suggested resources there, Destry?
So there was a plugin a while back on for Google Maps that you could find some of the 360 images and you could capture those. I can't remember off the top of my head what it was called. PanoFetch, PanoFetch. That was one that I had found that you could kind of capture some stuff from 360 from Google Maps. Otherwise, if you Google 360 images, there are a few places that will provide free resources for you to play around with. And there are also some paid resource files too. I try to capture all my own because when people start capturing them and trying to sell them, it's pretty expensive. So for some of those, so everywhere I go, I try to capture a handful of 360 images. That way I just kind of start building my own library. So
yeah, that's a great idea. Martine mentioned something called 360 cities, all one word. That's a cool one. Cities spelled just like you think. And Heather's saying that many stock companies have 360 imagery, like Adobe Stock, Getty Images, etc. Another question from Robin. Hey, Robin, is can a video be hosted somewhere else to keep the file size small? Very good question, and that is a great workaround to avoiding big AR projects. And the answer to that is yes. Basically, you would need to set up a server somewhere else and upload your videos there, and then long story short, you take the URL kind of a thing and plug that in and it plays it. It's similar-ish to YouTube in terms of how it works. It's a little bit smoother from the end user's experience, and it's a great way to reduce the file size, because instead of actually downloading the AR content onto your phone first and then playing the video, you're actually streaming it, which is really nice, especially if it's a bigger video. Just a really smooth way to get people into the AR experience faster, especially if they have a good connection. Let's see, any more questions? George is asking, can we execute AR for buildings to show how it looks in place before building it? Yeah, that's a really cool one. That's we've done that, especially in for architects. I mean, I'm not a very visual person. So when I look at like a blueprint, which is just 2D and flat and lines, it's really difficult to understand what that actually means. So creating a 3D version of a building is a really great way to to showcase and demonstrate what something could look like. And it's really powerful. One thing to note, again, Destry mentioned this, he touched on it earlier, is not all 3D model file types work. So something like CAD or BIM models that are really, really big, they don't work in Studio. You'll have to create a much smaller type. It's less about our software and much more about a mobile phone not being able to handle something that is designed for a really powerful computer. Otherwise, it's a fantastic use case. Absolutely. We have about 30 seconds left. Some of these questions here, I'll make sure to get back to you separately, just because they're outside of the scope of this of our webinar. So it's 5 p.m. here in London, which is the end of our AR webinar time. So thank you everyone for joining us today. It was a lot of fun talking with you. And thank you, Destry, for your time and for your knowledge and expertise. For anyone who has any questions, please feel free to send us an email at contact@zapper.com.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Take care.